This is Scottish Independence Podcast, episode number 185. This time, we're going to listen to a little talk by Billy Kay, who lots of you will know who he is already. He's been a guest on the show. He makes documentaries for the BBC and other places. He's a writer, activist. And this talk was from 2014, before the first referendum. But it's about nationalism and identity. And I think a lot of the things that he talks about are still extremely valid, in part because nationalism's a tricky concept. There's a kind of toxic form of it, and then there's a civic nationalism, which is obviously what Billy's talking about. But there's also so much more involved, in the sense that I'm sure some of you have been abroad in Spain or Italy or France or something, and it's amazing that they know the history of every little corner on these steps in 1275, this thing happened. But in Scotland, and also in England to a lesser extent, a lot of that stuff's just been wiped out, erased. We don't know about it. And one of the things that Billy underlines very much in this talk is why that might be the case. And not only that, but he tries to rectify it with some excellent little stories from Scottish history. Just to give you a couple of teasers, there's also some bits about special branches' involvement in infiltration in the Scottish independence movement. Also about which SNP MP was followed by Labour MPs around the Houses of Commons when it was dark. And which UK Prime Minister might have supported Scottish independence. So, all of that's in the talk. Have a wee listen, and have a wee word with you at the end.
Okay, good evening, ladies and gentlemen. Welcome to yet another 5 million questions event. This evening, I'm delighted to welcome to the University of Dundee, Billy Kay, who's going to talk about the cause, independence and identity. Billy Kay will probably be really well known to a Dundee audience, certainly should be known to a Scottish audience. He's a writer and historian. He's written several books, all of which, I don't know if I've read them all, but most of which I've read, certainly Knee Deep in Claret and The Mother Tongue and The Scottish World. If you haven't read those books, you will have the opportunity to have Billy sign one. Unfortunately, it's probably going to be a cash transaction required, but nevertheless, if you enjoy the talk, you might want to read more of Billy afterwards. He's a broadcaster, and indeed this talk tonight is partly based on a BBC series he did a year or so ago. He's a campaigner for all things Scottish, but certainly Scottish language, Scottish culture, and he is... I'm not sure if this is the best accolade, but it's certainly one that I enjoy making, and that he is a fellow supporter of Dundee United Football Club. And so he's particularly welcome as far as I'm concerned tonight. So, without further ado, can I welcome and invite to speak to us Billy Kay.
Thank you very much, and thank you to 5 Million Questions for inviting me here. I'd like to dedicate this talk this evening to a fellow Arab, Jimmy Halliday, who was the leader of SNP from 1956 to 1960. He was also a fellow Ayrshireman, and he died within the past year, so he will not see the referendum, but he was one of these pioneers who made sure that a referendum could happen. I'd like to mention a wee bit about my own background. And I say this because, not just because it's my background, but in a way, it's one of the major battlegrounds for the referendum vote. Because I'm from a working class west of Scotland, west central belt, Ayrshire background. And to me, that is where a lot of the votes can be won for yes or against yes. People who have to be turned from traditional Labour vote towards voting for independence. And I think that is happening, but it needs to happen to a greater extent. I was brought up in the Irvine Valley in a wee toon cried Gostin. Everything was seen through the prism of the Scots language. When we played FITBA, you had wingers duking down the wing. They would put our great boys for big centre forward days, claff it by the post or bluter it into the back of the neck. Ranger supporters go Oxter Cog, do the grun at Rugby Park. The whole thing was seen through the Scots language. And yet, that language wasn't taught in the school. One of the great ironies of an Ayrshire education in the 1950s was that you got a prize yea day a year for reciting Rabi's poetry and got the belt the other 364 days for speaking his language. My father was Auld Labour. very, very, very old Labour. But he was a cultural nationalist. He didn't have a political dimension to it, but he was very much a cultural nationalist. One of my memories as a wee boy, just after we get television, was seeing Sir Francis Chichester Clark arriving in, I think it was Southampton or Plymouth, after sailing single-handedly round the world on his yacht. And the English establishment was there to welcome him. And I said, "What do you think of that, Dad?" And my dad says, "Son, if a Scotsman was to swim single-handedly round the world, he wouldn't be getting this attention." So my dad was a cultural nationalist. But cut to an incident that shows you what's the kind of people that still have to be won over if you're a yes voter. 1990, was it 1990 or 1992, the election, where it was expected there would be a big surge of support for nationalism. I think one of the slogans was Scotland free by 93 at that time. And I was, because I was on television a bit at that time, and television confers celebrity, I was invited by Alex Neil to go out in the streets of Galston, where I come from, and proselytise for his party. And my dad was scunnered at the idea, his boy, Gnut, supporting the SNP in a traditional Labour heartland like that. But we agreed to disagree. And I went down from Newport and visited my dad and said, "Listen, I'll be going back up the road after I've left Alec Neil in the snappy bus, which is going to ruin Gosson. So I'll see you later on, Dad." But unbeknown to me, and by pure coincidence, the snappy bus stopped right underneath my father's window. The scene from Romeo and Juliet. Well, imagine a black and white version of that. There's the boy giving SNP propaganda with a megaphone at the bottom of the building, and there's my father giving me very rude gestures from the window up there. He was quite a thrown buddy, my dad, and we left it at that. But culturally, you couldn't have put a bit of paper between me and my father. But politically, he didn't have that nationalist dimension, which grew up in the 50s and 60s, and especially the 70s and 80s, which is what I'm talking about today. I got involved with Scotland United, with Common Cause, with a number of the pro-Parliament organisations. And I remember the night before the big demonstration for the 1997 Parliament referendum, Common Cause held a big gathering in the assembly rooms in George Street. And one of the speakers there was Shirley Williams. And Shirley said that while she supported democracy, she had a great fear of what she described as dark nationalism. And therefore she was worried about what was happening in Scotland. And then she said she was delighted that for the past 6 years she had lived in a country where nationalism didn't exist. I was waiting for the punchline to this, and then she said, "The United States of America." On my first morning in Manhattan, I saw children raise the American flag and sing "Rise and Shine, Bring Out Old Glory, Glory." Every American movie from Top Gun to The Patriot is a statement of American nationalism. Everywhere in America, you see the American flag outside people's houses. She feared dark nationalism. Scotland is a country where not a crown has been broken in its modern history of nationalism. In other words, for Shirley, big nation-state nationalism was normal and unquestioned, but small nationalism like Irish, Welsh or Scottish was to be feared. I mean, looking at nationalism, last summer, 2012, the summer of the Olympics and the Golden Jubilee, I've never seen a celebration of British nationalism or any nationalism like that, where the state broadcaster led in its news every day with the Olympics. So, in the Scottish media, out with the realm of football and rugby, I've never witnessed an overt and unqualified celebration of pride in Scottish national identity. So I was determined when I made the series, The Cause, to open the series with just such a statement. So, where do you begin a series on Scottish nationalism?
I'm standing on the field of Bannockburn, below the towering statue of Robert the Bruce. As the day of destiny dawned, Bruce told his people why they would prevail despite the overwhelming power ranged against them. We, for our lives and for our children and our wives and for the freedom of our land, are straining it in battle for to stand, and they for their micht innerly. They're here merely to demonstrate their might, while we come to defend everything we hold dear. The moral is clear. We hae the richt, and for the richt, ilk man should fecht. Almost 700 years later, remarkably, the Scottish cause is still a potent political force for the 21st century.
Said in the present day that Scottish patriotism is now more rampant than at any time since the Wars of Independence.
I would always say that nationalism is an extreme form of national identity. Nationalism is, if you like, the politicisation of national identity.
That was Professor Alan McInnes and Richard Finlay of Strathclyde University talking about modern nationalism. One of the people that I've interviewed in the past, one of the great historians of Scotland in the 20th century, was Professor Geoffrey Barrow. And at his inaugural lecture at Edinburgh University, he made some of these points that I'm making just now, that it was common to regard any Scottish history as parochial and inferior compared to British and Empire history. And he quoted a number of people in that inaugural lecture to show that. Now, that was a revolutionary statement back when he made it. Things have changed dramatically in the field of history. Scottish history has been normalised now. But back in the 60s and 70s, it was quite a statement to say that you were going to specialise in Scottish history. Richard Finlay there did his dissertation and then wrote a book about the rise of the SNP. And his colleagues told him not to write it because he would never get a job in that time. So the history that most of us got was we got in primary school, and it was the legends of Bruce and Wallace, and it was oral tradition. And I got that in Galston. Galston's mentioned in Barber's Bruce, the king lay into Golestoun, that is richt even anent loudoun. And from my father, I don't know if he got it from Barber or from the 18th century version that Burns got, but every time my uncle took us down to Ayr, we passed by a place called Barn Weal, and my father would say, "Burn ye weal, ye barns o' Ayr." And that was what Wallace is supposed to have said when he saw the great conflagration of the English Army of Occupation's camp at Barn Weal outside of Ayr. My grandmother stayed in Standalane Street in Goston. Wallace, when his forces deserted him, when a greater English force was coming towards him, is supposed to have said, "I stand alone in the face of the enemy." And I wanted to collect some of this oral tradition for the series and show how powerful it could be. In the next extract, you'll hear the voice of the First Minister, Alex Salmond, and the stories he got as a wee boy from his grandfather. And then the historian Fiona Watson, talking about a woman who I think is one of the greatest women and greatest patriots in Scottish history, the Countess of Buchan. So this is number two, please, Charles.
My granddad was the town plumber in Linlithgow, who took me around the town, and as he took me around the town, Linlithgow at the centre of Scottish history, told me great deeds of derring do that had happened in and around Linlithgow. How the castle as it was then, the palace as it is now, was taken back by Bruce's men by putting a hay cart in the portcullis and charging in. And the way my granddad told it, of course, it, you know, he didn't just say this happened. He named the people who'd been involved. He said, "Oh, well, some Cunningham's involved, some Davidson, some Oliphants." Of course, Oliphants were the local bakers in Linlithgow. So I had this kind of image in my childlike eyes of the lads in the bakehouse dusting down their overalls and charging up to the palace and taking it back for Scotland. So I got Braveheart from my grandfather's knee, and with due respect to Braveheart, which I thought was a great film, incidentally, it was much more compelling much more intimate, much more immediate, and all told through this kind of prism of it all happened in or around Livgeatoun.
I think she's one of the bravest people in Scottish history. Isabella, the Countess of Buchan, but she's actually Isabella of Fife. She's a Macduff. Her nephew is the current Earl of Fife, but he is in England. He's been brought up in England. When Bruce rushes to Scone to be inaugurated as king in March 1306, she realises that the traditional role played by the Earl of Fife is not going to be done for Bruce because her nephew won't be there. The Earls of Fife have, for a century or so, taken the lead in the inauguration process, putting the crown on the king's head. So she leaves her husband. Her husband is the uncle of the man, John Comyn of Badenoch, that Robert Bruce killed in the Church of the Grey Friars. So she knew that by going to Scone, she was leaving her marriage, leaving the life of comparative luxury that she would have enjoyed as a noble woman, as a countess, to who knows what. As far as she was concerned, her life ended, really, with that incredible patriotic gesture. It was politics and identity and a sense that he could not be king unless she took that role. She arrived at Scone and placed the crown on Bruce's head. She was captured along with the Bruce women a few months later, and Edward's wrath against her and a number of the other Bruce women was such that she spent a few years in a cage in Berwick.
That incident of the Bruce women, including Countess of Buchan and the wife and daughter of Robert the Bruce, being put in a cage and hung outside the castles at, I think it was Berwick and Roxburgh, was an act of barbarity that went against the whole tradition of chivalry in that period. Normally, nobility looked after nobility, and this kind of thing couldn't happen. But because they were regarded as treasonable, then they could do with them what they liked. I heard an interview a few years ago on Radio Scotland where they were interviewing some of the early suffragettes. And this old lady recalled a great procession, a great demonstration for the suffragettes in Princes Street in Edinburgh. And she described some of the floats. And the one that stuck in her mind was this memory of a cage with noble women inside of it. And she couldn't remember the significance of it. And I'm listening to it, and I knew the significance of it. The presenter hadn't a clue the significance of it. The old lady had lost it, and the producer hadn't a clue of the significance of it. And that's the tragedy of a people who are uneducated in their own history and culture, that you lose knowledge of what your people have done over the centuries. And there, the suffragettes were using the tradition of the Wars of Independence to celebrate their own freedom for women to get the vote. And this popular nationalist ethos, I say, lasted right through the centuries. Robert Burns said, "The story of Wallace poured a Scottish prejudice in my veins, which will boil along there till the floodgates of life shut in eternal rest." Both my great-grandfathers were miners. Fife miners from a communist tradition and Ayrshire miners from the tradition of Keir Hardie. And in the 19th century, the Scottish coal field developed an organisation called the Free Colliers, with influences from Freemasonry, but a prototype of the National Union of mine workers, really. And there is one of these Free Colliers associations still on the go. They march every year outside Falkirk, and I'd like to let you hear a wee clip from the Free Colliers demonstration, again to show how working class radicalism tied in with the image of the Wars of Independence. Number three, please, Charles.
I feel very proud as an ex-miner.
Why do you think the miners identified with Wallace? They carry Wallace in their banners.
Because he fought for freedom, and the miners' union fought for freedom.
All my forefathers were Lanarkshire miners, serfs, slaves. This is the mark of remembrance of them.
We're representing our forefathers for years gone by. Wallace was obviously the bravest Scotsman that's ever lived. So the Colliers in these times, they were brave guys and all, because they're going to do work in terrible conditions, eh?
The reason for Bruce and Wallace is because they fought for freedom for Scotland. And the Free Colliers, when they were first formed and instituted, that's why they were fighting for their rights as free men.
I'm in the former mining community of Reading near Falkirk, where Grandmaster William Allardyce and the men of the Sir William Wallace Grand Lodge of Scotland Free Colliers are staging their annual demonstration. It began back in the industrial disputes of the 1860s, when yet again the cause of working class solidarity drew inspiration from the struggle for Scottish independence.
The tune of Scots Wha Hae there, interestingly, has been a song of freedom for centuries before Burns put the words of Scots Wha Hae to it. It was called Hae Tutty Tatey, and it was a pipe tune that was played, for example, by the corps of La Garde Écossaise du Corps du Roi, the personal bodyguard of the French Dauphin, when the Scots helped the French Liberation Army lift the siege at Orléans. And it's become, because of that, it's a march, a French military march, as well as being the tune to Scots Wha Hae. It's known as La Marche Triomphale de l'Entrée de Jean La Pucelle à Orléans, the triumphal march of Jean La Pucelle, Joan of Arc, into Orléans. And it's still played as a French military march to this day, sometimes called La Marche de Robert Bruce aussi. It was played when the Channel Tunnel was opened. The French guard played it there, much to Mrs. Thatcher's astonishment. With that popular oral tradition, Guy Little would have survived if it hadn't been for that oral tradition. But, so even though the west of Scotland, for example, was the cradle of the Industrial Revolution, when we did industrial history at school in my day, most of it was about Manchester and places like that. This produced... One of the results of this was, I think, the heart and head division that a lot of Scots have, and is beautifully depicted in Sunset Song by Lewis Grassett Gibbon. So that was Chris and her reading and schooling. Two Chrises there were that fought for her heart and tormented her. You hated the land and the coarse speak of the folk, and learning was brave and fine one day, and the next you'd waken with the peeweets crying across the hills, deep and deep, crying in the heart of you, and the smell of the earth in your face, almost you'd cry for that, the beauty of it, and the sweetness of the Scottish land and skies. You saw their faces in firelight, fathers and mothers and the neighbours, before the lamps lit up, tired and kind, faces dear and close to you. You wanted the words they'd known and used, forgotten in the far-off youngness of their lives, Scots words to tell to your heart how they wrung it and held it, the toil of their day and unendingly their fight. And the next minute, that passed from you. You were English. Back to the English words, so sharp and clean and true, for a while, till they slid so smooth from your throat, you knew they could never say anything that was worth the saying at all. Lewis Grassett Gibbon's famous passage from Sunset Song. Staying with languages for a second, my passport to university was the fact that I had a facility for modern languages. I did higher Russian at Kilmarnock Academy, and I could speak French and German reasonably, and did higher French and German, hitchhiked to France and Germany when I was 16, and could get by in the languages. And I went to university because of that, and because you could get grants in those days. But I remember in my first year at university, when I was Guy Vanty that I could speak French and German, I saw an interview with the great actor, Peter Ustinov, who's got associations with this university. And Ustinov was interviewed. And the interviewer said, "It's remarkable, Mr. Ustinov. I understand that you can speak seven languages fluently." And Ustinov replied and says, "Yes, that's all very well, but I usually find that people who speak six or seven languages fluently don't have anything of interest to say in any of them." And that got through to me because there I was proud of my knowledge of French and German, but I knew nothing about my own history and my culture. So I changed to doing Scottish literature and concentrated on learning about my own culture, as well as continuing with my interest in languages, and I still do that. The Scottish cringe was one of the things that I think we all grew up with in that period. Post-union history was ignored until the interest in the rise of Scottish nationalism sparked an interest in it. I realised that something was wrong in the state of Scotland in my education when Near Kilmarnock Academy, there's a wonderful library called the Dick Institute. And I used to go there and scour the bookshelves at lunchtime. And I came across this book, The Scottish Insurrection of 1820. And I went, Scottish Insurrection, 1820? And I opened it up, and there was Galston and Yamils and Darvel. There were people with the names of kids in my class at school planting the Tree of Liberty and joining the Friends of the People and the United Scotsmen and then joining the Weavers' Revolt and coming out in 1820. And I thought, if I don't know this, what else don't I know? And that gave me a great interest in Scottish history. And for the series The Cause, the 1820 Society has annual commemorations of all of these events of the 1820 rising. And here you can hear a vox pop of a few people, Ian Bain and Michael Donnelly, talking about the importance of the 1820 Weavers' Revolt. Number four, please.
The significance, really, of Bonnymuir is just part of a huge rising which affected the whole of the industrial west of Scotland, with about 30 to 60,000, depending on the various estimates, of workers downing tools. It was the first industrial general strike in the world.
And three men were hung and beheaded for it, ultimately. What was their motivation? What was the prime motivation?
Well, it's about democracy, and of course in a Scottish context it's about Scottish democracy. And we could say that this was the start of a process whereby the ordinary people of Scotland decided that it was time for them to have a say in the running of their country. And of course we could argue that the logical conclusion of that is in the Scottish context that you have a Scottish national self-determination. And so these men have set a Scottish agenda which we have yet to complete.
The wee clips of music that you're hearing there and I played before the evening began, the story behind that is when I was at Bonnymuir, a gentleman came up to me at the end of the ceremony and said, I hear you're doing a programme. And he said, my daughter wrote this piece of music about the 1820 rising. I've heard a lot of stories like this before and usually I dismiss them. But he asked if he could send me the piece of music. And when I got it, I just found it so moving. The air itself and the words that young Sarah McNeill, who was a student at the Royal Conservatoire, now left. She did her dissertation on Scottish political song and wrote this piece of music about the 1820 revolt. It's called Free or a Desert. And that's based on the old flag that the weavers carried, which was Scotland Free or a Desert, which was an echo of an old covenanting flag from the 17th century. And Sarah combined a sad piece of music with a celebration of the life of Baird, Hardy and Wilson, the men who were executed for treason in the 1820 rising. And she put the words of Baird and Hardy as they were going to the scaffold, the recorded words, as a voiceover, and a wee piece of Lord Byron's poetry. They never fall who die in a great cause. The block may soak their gore, their heads may sodden in the sun, their limbs be strung to city gates and castle walls, but still their spirit walks abroad. And I found the fact that she chose Byron very interesting, because Byron was one of these Scottish figures, like Boswell in Corsica, like Lord Admiral Cochrane in Chile, like Byron in Greece, like Cochrane in Greece, Scots who got involved in other people's liberation struggles and contributed a lot to it and quoted Bruce and Wallace while they were involved in these struggles. So Sarah put this music and then added these words. And she asked me if I would do the voiceover for the recording for it. So I'll just let you hear a wee bit of it. This is number five, please.
My race is run, and my sun about to set, and never more to rise in this world. I die firm to the cause like a magnet to its pole, with undaunted spirit and unshaken soul. I shall lay down my life without the least reluctance, knowing it for the cause of truth and justice. My dear friend, I must bid you farewell, and I hope you'll keep in your remembrance the cause for which Baird and Hardy die on the scaffold. Again, farewell, till I hope we meet in glory.
That's the music of Sarah McNeill. Baird and Hardy were hung and decapitated. 12 years later, the Reform Act was passed and much of what they had demanded was granted, except for the restoration of the Scottish Parliament, which would wait a long, long time. One of the joys of working in this field is incidents like Sarah's music. In the past, I did a programme called From the Gorbals to Wee Door about the history of the Glasgow Irish, and Blair Douglas wrote a great tune called From the Gorbals to Wee Door based on it. I wrote I took an English song from Durham and put Scottish words in the chorus and set it in the Midlothian coalfield, and that became the Midlothian Miners' Song. And it's now sung as a traditional Scottish song by about 5 different groups in Scotland. If you go on YouTube and type it in, you'll find a various bands singing the Midlothian Miners' Song. Well, the Scottish version of it was written in my office in the BBC in 1981, and it's now a traditional song. Such joys make up for the downside on what I call the cultural inferiorisation that exists in Scotland. When my wife and I moved to Fife from Edinburgh, we visited local primary schools. And in one of the local primary schools, I asked the headmaster if Scottish studies were encouraged in the school. And he replied, "No, not really. This is not a very Scottish area." An education convener in a region not far from this building during the same period of the 80s, someone suggested that Scottish studies should be an integral part of the school's curriculum, and the Labour convener replied, "Oh no, we live in a multicultural environment." In other words, every culture was to be taught except the native one in that environment. It's because of attitudes like that that when somebody like Alistair Gray and Jim Kelman say that it's a natural thing that the head of Creative Scotland should know something about Scottish culture, that the press goes mental and accuses them of being anti-English. It's a very strange society we live in, with its heart and head division about being Scottish and being British. And I've experienced one or two horror stories myself. Two of them were from Labour culture ministers. One again was asked, and this was when I got, I wasn't there, but a friend heard it, was asked if Scottish studies shouldn't be encouraged in the schools, and she replied, "Oh no, I'm not raising a generation of nationalists." And another one, which I did experience, was where I'm involved in the cross-party group for the Scots language at the Parliament, and I asked a Minister of Culture if he'd received the invitation to appear in front of the cross-party group at the Parliament for the Scots language. And he said, the invitation was written in English and in Scots. And his reply was, "Oh, that thing written in the funny language, I threw it in the bin." That was a Minister of Culture in the Scottish Government 12 years ago. So that is the attitude that you're coming across, attitudes that are unthinkable in normal countries. Yet we're so conditioned to having an idea of our culture having less status that anyone expressing the norm of a culture promoting its own culture are set upon. Here are a few voices on this subject from the series The Cause talking about this thing of cultural inferiorisation. Number 6, please, Charles.
As any student of imperialism will tell you, one of the first things that an imperialist power does is it denigrates and it trashes the indigenous culture. It makes it appear worthless.
I remember quite clearly getting strapped for using Scots in the classroom. These kind of things, to me, are a bit sad because it creates a kind of dichotomy in a Scottish mind. To get on in the world, you've got to speak proper. But for goodness sake, don't expect guid.
My education in Scots comprised 2 Burns poems, nothing more. Furthermore, my history book, after 1707, consistently referred to England instead of Great Britain. And I found that offensive at the time. I remember protesting.
The songs we sang were "Who is Sylvia?", "What is she?", and "The British Grenadiers". I remember one of the lecturers talking about James I and Robert Henryson and William Dunbar and who was the fourth one?
Gavin Douglas.
And she was talking about them and she said they're sometimes referred to as the Scottish Chaucerians. But of course, it might seem absurd to refer to minor Scottish poets in the same breath as Geoffrey Chaucer.
When you hear attitudes like that, I think of Hugh McDermid's poem where God is speaking to a Scotsman and the Scotsman says, "Mercy o' God, I canna thole with sic an oary mob to roll." And God says, "Wheesht, it's for the good of your soul." It may be for the good of your soul, but what it does to my head is something else. It had reached a stage in Scottish universities in the 50s and 60s that even the Scottish Enlightenment was hardly taught. One of the men who's promoted the Scottish Enlightenment, Alexander Brodie, written most of the books about the Scottish Enlightenment, described how all he got of Scottish philosophy at Edinburgh University was a little bit of David Hume. Adam Smith was not taught. He was not taught at that time because he was Scottish, and anything Scottish was regarded as not worth teaching. That's how bad it had got in our culture at that time. To quote Fionn McCullough, we were too long in this condition. And a lot of people started reacting against this. One of the people I interviewed was Professor Cairns Craig, who had been at Edinburgh University roughly the same time I was there. And he said he went in a socialist and came out a nationalist because of what was not being taught in philosophy, in literature, etc., etc. When the SNP tried to put down roots, especially in central Scotland, it was in a very hostile environment. And I'll let you hear some of the pioneers of the SNP in this period talk about what it was like confronting the hostility that they faced. This is number 7, please.
We had one member in Ayr, we had one member in St Andrews, we had one member in Wick, we had one member in Skye. That's the kind of absurdity you're dealing with.
It was a sect. It was curiously like Trotskyism, actually, and it was something which was, at that time, a blind alley.
I was 17 before I met another nationalist. It was not an issue at that time, it was just not thought of.
The Cyclist Touring Club dispersed its monthly magazine, and inside was a leaflet from the Cooperative Holidays Association advertising tours to Scotland. This was embellished with wonderful words. The land of bagpipes, tartan, shortbread tins, Loch Lomond, the Scottish Nationalists. So we were actually seen as a kind of tourist target. This was in 1961.
It was part of the quaintness of Scotland, in a way.
Part of our funny little tartan treasure house.
When I was first married and my children were very small, I put up posters for one of the campaigns. And a neighbour came to me and said, "You're Scottish Nationalists." And I said, "Yes." And they said, "But I've never met a Scottish Nationalist before. And you're such nice people."
I did a report for Edinburgh branch of the SNP, and I handed it in at the Herald office in Edinburgh, and the journalist on duty took it and said, "I'll send it through to Glasgow, I'll give them a laugh anyway." And I thought, how ignorant a remark. What we're talking about was material about Scotland and its nationhood.
To declare yourself a nationalist or to talk for independence for Scotland was, frankly, a social embarrassment.
In these early days, it wasn't unusual for me to perhaps to find one or two nationalists in an evening, whole evening, one or two. I remember ringing the doorbell once and somebody said, "Oh, quick," calling his wife, "here's somebody from the Scottish National Party having a joke."
I remember we went canvassing with a friend of mine, Archie Young, to this house, and the lady answered the door and asked we'd be coming and help her lay a carpet. Which we did. Then we were sure she went away and voted Labour.
I remember leafleting in Marchmont in Edinburgh, and I was so frightened of the reaction when they picked up the leaflet that I had put through the letterbox. Sometimes they came out and shouted at you, and I would climb to the third floor and come down as quickly as possible so that I was out of the building before they picked up the leaflet.
Giving up a shot. Some voices there of those early days. It was almost going against the sense of loyalty to the British state that these people were doing. The stealing or the repatriation of the Stone of Destiny, John McCormick's successful rectorial campaign at Glasgow University raised the profile. But Gordon Casler tells the story of his father was in the CID, and when he joined the SNP, within days, His father was told by the special branch that his son had joined the SNP. And as with the 1820 radical rising, the state employed agent provocateur to ensnare potential troublemakers. In the Stone of Destiny incident, Jimmy Halliday was a law-abiding nationalist student. He was approached by a gentleman who offered explosive expertise and suggested targets to him. Number 9, please.
Well, he said, the best thing you could do, I think, is to blow up the bridges at Berwick. So I thought, boy, we've got a right one here.
The Glasgow students declined responding.
Don't know whether you're a journalist looking for a story or a government spy looking for a victim. I think it's the latter. We never saw him again. A year later, 4 Edinburgh students were tried and jailed for planning to blow up the General Post Office in Edinburgh. And they had been put up to it by a special constable who was a taxi driver. When people then say, oh, I don't think that sort of thing happens, I say, well, I assure you, it did.
I know a distinguished professor at an ancient Scottish university who was involved in democratic cultural national activities as late as the 1980s in Aberdeen. He had his flat raided regularly by the special branch and police. And in one of the visits, the policeman, regarding his Scottish flag on his wall, asked him what he was doing with that rag on the wall. Yet throughout the 20th century, this faithful remnant, if you like, regarded themselves as the inheritors of a mainstream tradition, with echoes going through the Covenanters to Keir Hardie to the rise of socialism. In fact, in the flamboyant founding figure of the National Party, they even had the rebirth of the King o'er the Water. This is the late Muriel Gibson remembering Don Roberto, R.B. Cunningham Graham, at the Bannockburn rallies in the 1930s. Number 10.
I joined the National Party in 1932, and the annual highlight was going to Bannockburn. At the head of the procession marching through Stirling was this man on horseback, Cunningham Graham. Of course, he was a born rider, and he always looked out of time if you wrote him in. I could have imagined him quite easily as a cavalier. He just had a very special aura around him. He was slim, he was very aristocratic looking, and altogether an absolutely romantic figure.
This is Don Roberto as a gaucho in Argentina, aged 18, and this is him riding his horse on an Argentinian book that my daughter brought back from Argentina a few years ago. Artists and writers were at the core of the movement. Compton Mackenzie, Hugh McDermott, Cunningham Graham, Eric Linklater, Neil Gunn, all combining radical socialism and nationalism. They were drawn on a tradition started in the Celtic Revival by, again, someone with an association with Dundee University, the great Patrick Geddes, Geddes Quadrangle, down the road there. They were considered that they were continuing a radical tradition. And here's some oral history of an ex-Labour voter, an ex-Fife miner, Derek Maguire, talking about what he thinks has happened with the party that he used to support. And here's Winnie Ewing talking about her ties with the older Labour Party. Number 11, please.
It just made me wonder how they reconcile their current stance with their roots and where they came from, because their founding fathers were as firmly in favour of Home Rule for Scotland as their opponents in the SNP. And there's times, talk about burling in folks' graves, I don't know if Keir Hardie's should be fitted with a rev counter.
When I joined the SNP at university, I came home and told my father I've joined the SNP. And he said, you're a traitor to the working class. My father had supported the early Labourites when they wanted Home Rule. And, of course, I knew all kinds of old famous guys. And the Labour Party hated my connections. Couldn't bear it. Because not only had I got their seat, but I'd also got splendid connections.
R.B. Cunningham Graham founded the Scottish Labour Party with Keir Hardie in 1888. Then in 1928, he founded the National Party of Scotland. And he challenged his countrymen in a great saying, which I think should be used more often by the Yes side in this debate. Cunningham Graham, I think it was at the Bannockburn rally, said, "The enemies of Scottish nationalism are not the English," he wrote, "for they were forever... The enemies of Scottish nationalism are not the English, for they were ever a great and generous folk, quick to respond when justice calls. Our real enemies are among us, born without imagination." MacDermid came away with wonderful ringing statements. "A Scottish poet mun assume the burden is people's doom, and die to break their living tomb." But gradually, the SNP began to win seats and began to create a new kind of politics. There's a wee clip here where you can hear the reaction in the central belt of SNP beginning to take Labour seats. Winnie Ewing was used to the rough and tumble of Glasgow, being a lawyer in Glasgow, but she wasn't prepared at all for the hostility that she got in the House of Commons. Number 12, please. This is a piece of oral history about Winnie and the reaction she developed.
"I was an enemy, but they didn't stand for Labour anymore. They'd given it up anyway. My father'd never given it up. I knew they were sham people. I had utter contempt for them all. And they knew that, of course. And you see, what they couldn't go over was I had friends that went away back, quite distinguished members of the Labour hierarchy and the Lords. That annoyed the Labour Party terribly.
They had their jobs and careers in Westminster, and they did not like it.
The Tories were always kind. The Liberals were always kind. The English were always kind. The Welsh were always kind. And the Irish were always kind. The only exceptions to the rule of chivalry, which was very strong, was the Labour Party from the central belt. And they were not kind. Sometimes I was followed in the House of Commons at dark. When the House put the lights out, you were in darkness then, but you knew your way and there were certain lights. I was followed at dark of night by members of the Labour Party.
To intimidate you?
Yes, I was intimidated. I lost a stone in weight. I became very worried about my weight and I really had a problem then. I was down to about 7 stone in the House of Commons.
One of the people who stopped the intimidation of Winnie. Winnie was a great friend of Emrys Hughes, the son-in-law of Keir Hardie. And when she told Emrys Hughes what was happening, Emrys took Winnie to Harold Wilson, who was also a friend of Winnie, and he was horrified and immediately put a stop to it. But that shows you the kind of intimidation that was going on to a young woman in the Parliament at that time. Of course, they could give just as good on the other side. One of the wits of the national movement was a marvellous character called Oliver Brown. And the Scottish Independent newspaper offers an award for people in the media who've promoted Scottish culture. And I was very delighted to receive it a few years ago. And I read up on Oliver. He called the institution I broadcast on, the BBC, as he called it, the Anglo-Saxophone, which is... And when Winnie won Hamilton, he wrote, "A shudder went through the Scottish members of Parliament, frantically looking for a spine to run up." Gradually, though, a new style of politics developed. And this is a humorous wee sequence here about the fact that young women like Margot MacDonald and Winnie were taking the place of old fuddy-duddies in the movement. And this is number 13, please. This is Ron Ferrari.
"When he went to get elected, I had a Ferrari car, open taupe, white, and he was standing in the passenger seat and I was driving him all around all the yokel villages. Every one of them, they were shouting and great atmosphere."
That must have been quite stylish, a Ferrari car promoting the SNP.
Couldn't have done enough for him.
On one famous occasion, I was able to persuade a friend who was an airline pilot to charter a small airplane, and we flew to the different parts of Argyll. Another year, I can recall chartering a yacht. I think they appreciated it for two reasons. One was obviously a certain amount of dash and swagger to it, but secondly, it made me very available.
The wonderful Ron Ferrari and Ian McCormick, the son of John McCormick there. Ron was also aware of the fact that Wallace Monument had been contributed to by Garibaldi, the great Italian patriot. And as a Scots-Italian, he was very proud of that. Through the 70s and 80s, the nationalist movement got a lot stronger. And eventually, you had the referendum of 79, a disaster for the SNP. I remember after it, though, I was interviewed by magazine Radical Scotland that was on the go at the time. The interviewer, I'm delighted to say, was a young man called James Robertson, who's made quite a name for himself as a novelist since then. And I remember I had a friend in Edinburgh University who was a pioneer surfer in Scotland from California, and I used a surfing metaphor that we had missed this wave, but another bigger one was coming along, and that was the one in 1999. And I'm sure there's an even bigger one coming along very, very soon. One so big that the unionists are cowering in fear that it'll be a tsunami which will sweep away the bridges that link us to England and they'll never see their grannies anymore. Dundee historians will recognise the echo there of Neddy Scrimgeour, the Prohibition candidate against Winston Churchill earlier in the 20th century. His supporters had a rhyme that went, "Vote, vote, vote for Neddy Scrimgeour. He's the boy who'll gie ye ham and eggs. If you dinna vote for him, then we'll bash your windies in and you'll never see your granny ony mair." In that period of the 1997 election, I was involved with a common cause in organising a thing called the Bus Party, in which writers and artists went round Scotland for pro-yes, yes meetings. We held one in Dundee, and writers like Robert Crawford, who's coming here in a few weeks' time, and Matthew Fitt, and singers like Rod Patterson and Sheena Wellington contributed to that. And for those of you interested in the cultural argument for the debate, a date for your diary, May the 27th, this year, in Gardine Theatre, the Bus Party is being revived, and James Robertson and Kareen Polwart and Janice Galloway and a great number of contemporary singers, musicians and poets and writers will be taking part in that. We're going to release the details in April, but we're going to be in Dundee on May the 27th for a free event in the Gardine Theatre, if you're available. My hope is that this next surge will create the modern, inclusive, socially just Scotland that we all want and we all desire. And this history of egalitarianism, which you can accuse me of being a romantic, but the history of inclusiveness goes back to the founding of boroughs like Dundee, back in the 12th century, when the royal proclamations addressed Frankis et Scottis, Anglis et Flemingis, the Flemish, the French, the English and the Scots inhabiting the early boroughs of Scotland. And this is Humza Yousaf and Gordon Casely talking about the kind of Scotland that they want and the kind of Scotland that they see reflected in the culture they've come from themselves. Number 16, please.
My dad was the first non-white member of the SNP in Glasgow back in 1974. You know, he was a complete black sheep. He was the only SNP in the community, you know, the only SNP here in the village, as it was. If you were an Asian, you supported Labour, no ifs, no buts. And he was the only one, and that was because he believed inherently that independence was the right thing for Scotland, because it was the right thing for Pakistan. It was the right thing from his grandfather's point of view for India, and it was the right thing here.
There was a period when we had settler watch, and things like that leave me feeling very uncomfortable. I don't like it. People who come to Scotland normally come of their own volition. They've made a choice. They want to come here, and I think we should welcome them. We exist in Scotland on hybridity. We have for over 2,000 years. So the body politic of Scotland is not some pedigree strain of blood running through us. It's all of us who are here at this time. I welcome in a bootcomers. They add to us, they improve us, and that makes us the nation we are today.
I'll end with that heart and head duality referred to earlier. I find it ironic so far that the Yes campaign has focused solely on the head rather than the heart, because I think it's the culture and identity which is where my cultural commitment comes from, and many of my generation, that's what motivates them. I hope they get it right, because the depression of the national psyche of a no vote is, to people like me, unthinkable. Anyway, a last piece of oral history. It's very short, so I'll not play it, but just tell you the story. I think it's remarkable. and it refers to this heart and head division. One of my favourite quotes from Lord Byron, I quoted from earlier, is, "For I am half a Scot by birth and bred a whole one, and my heart flies to my head." Well, Winnie Ewing told me a story of in the 1960s on Burns Night, she was sitting having a dram early on a Friday evening with Sir Alec Douglas Hume, just before the both of them went out to different Burns suppers in London. This took place in the Caledonian Club. I've delivered the immortal memory there, and it's a real pillar of the British establishment, the Caledonian Club. Anyway, Sir Alec Douglas Hume and Winnie were chatting over their dram. And to Winnie's astonishment, Sir Alec Douglas Hume said, "Winnie, in my heart, I'm a Scottish nationalist." This is the Prime Minister, this is the aristocratic family, this is the pillar of British unionism. "In my heart, I'm a Scottish nationalist, but my head tells me otherwise." And Winnie, quick as a flash, said, "Ah, but Alec, you know what Robert Burns would have said to you? The hurt eyes the paired eye that marks us recht or wrang." The full quote of that is, "Nae treasures nor pleasures can mak us happy lang. The hurt eyes the paired eye that marks us recht or wrang." So, if like Sir Alec, you're swithering whether to go with hurt or heed, I'll leave you the words of another giant of Scottish literature and two quotes to keep in mind when you go into the booth to vote. One is personal. "To be yourselves and to mak that worth being, nae harder job to mortals has been gien, and one national, for we hae faith in Scotland's hidden poors, the present's theirs, but o' the past and future's oors." Thank you very much, ladies and gentlemen.
So there you go, hope you enjoyed that. Thanks again to Billy Kay for letting me reproduce the talk here. Finally, if you'd like to subscribe to the YouTube channel or follow us on Twitter or Facebook, all the links are in the show notes. That's it for this episode. I'll be back with something again soon. Speak to you next time, and I'll leave you with this.
We about to get all the kids, the brothers, the sisters, the regular.
Extending across the atlas, I begat this, flipping in together on the dirty mattress. You can't match this, rapper slash actress, more powerful than two Cleopatras. Bomb graffiti on the tomb of Nefertiti. MCs ain't ready to take it to the Serengeti. My rhymes is heavy, like the mind of Sister Betty. L Boogie spars with stars and constellations. Then came down for a little conversation.
adjacent to the king, fear no human being. Roll with cherubims to Nassau Coliseum. Now hear this mixture where hip hop meets scripture. Develop a negative into a positive picture.
Now everything is everything.
Sometimes it seems.
Sometimes it seems.
We'll touch that dream.
We'll touch that
but
dream.
Things come slow and not at all.
They come slow.
And the ones on time.
The ones on time.
Won't make it stop. So convinced that they might fall. Let's love ourselves and we can't fail. To make a better situation.
Everything is everything.
Everything is everything.
Everything is everything.
Everything is everything.